Gettysburg, May of 1973. I'm not sure if anyone here was on that trip, but that was the first time, and then once down on LaSalle Street in the Loop, and actually Ulysses S. Grant conference in Schaumburg in 1885, and now here tonight. Different venues on every occasion, yet united by the common interest that we have and by the pioneering work that your round table has rendered to the Civil War profession and to our nation. I hope you realize what great respect everyone who has a love of the Civil War, whether a professional historian or a Civil War buff or howsoever we may term the person, you set the pace. You established the model, which is now flourishing all across our country. My wife Tracy and I are active in the Harrisburg Civil War Roundtable in Pennsylvania. But all roundtables look up to your organization, and it's good to see you here, still flourishing, carrying on the noble tradition that Ralph Newman and Pete Long and your renowned founders established so many decades ago. So I'm happy to be back here with you tonight to share some thoughts on Richmond Redeemed, Enduring Lessons in Leadership from the Siege of Petersburg. Now, the Siege of Petersburg proved one of the longest operations of the Civil War, some 9.5 months from mid-June of 1864 to early April of 1865. It pitted two of the greatest generals of American history directly against each other, Robert E. Lee and Ulysses S. Grant. Was it a matter of their fighting against John B. Floyd or John C. Pemberton or Ambrose E. Burnside? This was Grant and Lee directly against each other. And it was waged by two of the finest armies in America that America has ever raised, the resilient Federal Army of the Potomac and the hard-hitting Confederate Army of Northern Virginia. Those worthy antagonists, which had grappled for the entire war, certainly on the peninsula, the 7 days, which you'll be covering on your upcoming field trip and in so many other operations, were again locked in the Siege of Petersburg. And they were reinforced by several new armies, which had been created only in 1864. Serving in those armies were senior subordinates who had figured prominently in earlier battles in the Eastern Theater. These subordinates included such prominent Northern commanders as George G. Meade, Winfield Scott Hancock, and Gouverneur Kay Warren, and such senior Southern soldiers as James Longstreet, Richard S. Ewell, and A.P. Hill. And with that prelude, let us briefly summarize the siege before we essay to assess it. Petersburg, Virginia, situated on the right bank of the Appomattox River, 20 miles due south of Richmond, was militarily important in its own right. The second largest city of Virginia, the seventh largest city of the Confederacy, the head of navigation on the Appomattox River, the location of the Confederate States lead works, which manufactured bullets for the Confederate Army. However, the strategic significance of Petersburg lay in logistics. Throughout the Civil War, Petersburg functioned as the rail center for the Confederate capital. From northeast, southeast, south, and west, railroads ran into the Cockade City, as Petersburg was nicknamed. From there, a single railroad continued north to the Confederate capital. Foodstuffs from fertile Southside Virginia, armaments from ports along the lower Atlantic coast into which blockade runners came, lead and salt from southwestern Virginia, and most vitally, reinforcements all funneled through Petersburg to get to Richmond. Only one other railroad running southwest through Danville and the Carolina Piedmont connected the capital with the rest of the Confederacy. Defending Petersburg and its supply lines was crucial to defending Richmond itself. Capturing the cockade city would comparably cripple the capital. In the first 3 years of the Civil War, those dangers remained distant as Lee's masterful generalship kept the Union as far from Richmond and its rail center. Illinois' own son, Ulysses S. Grant, changed all that. By the spring of 1864, Grant served as General-in-Chief of the entire United States Army, as Eastern Theater Commander, and as Commander of what I like to term Army Group Grant. Now that term is admittedly anachronistic, not in parlance in the Civil War, but it so accurately describes the command structure. An Army Group is a group of armies. When you take your 2018 field trip on the Atlantic campaign, you'll see that Sherman is commanding an army group in the west. Well, Grant was commanding an army group in the east. And so, if you'll indulge me, I'll use that term, army group commander. And in all three of these capacities, General-in-Chief, Eastern Theater Commander, Army Group Commander, Grant carried the war from Central Virginia to the vicinity of Richmond. In 30 days of almost incessant fighting, from the Battle of the Wilderness on May 5th and 6th to the Second Battle of Cold Harbor on June 1st to 3rd, the Illinoisan compelled the Confederates to concede their forward position and confronted them with the constriction of the close and confined coverage of their capital. Then, in a daring southward strike in mid-June, Grant crossed the Chickahominy River, bridged the mighty James River itself, and attacked the capital's crucial communications center, Petersburg. His leading corps overran the outer defenses, but did not capture the cockade city itself. Federal failure to recognize opportunity, plus heroic defense by the Butternuts, first under Louisiana's own great general, P.G.T. Beauregard, and later under Lee himself, saved the city. A grand assault by the Unionists on June 18th was bloodily repulsed. Even worse disaster befell the Yankee efforts to cut the communications south of the cockade city less than a week later in the First Battle of the Weldon Railroad. Those dual defeats on June 18th and June 22nd, 23rd ended the mobile warfare of spring that had carried the armies from the Rapidan to the Appomattox. Thereafter, operations stagnated into the slowness of summer as the Siege of Petersburg began. Now, this siege was not tactical. It lacked the saps and parallels and breaching batteries that had typified European siege warfare since the era of Marshal Vauban in the 17th century, the reign of King Louis XIV. Even the several mines at Petersburg, including the infamous Battle of the Crater on July 30th, were aberrations, utterly uncharacteristic of the siege. Yet Petersburg unquestionably was a siege. On the higher planes of operations, strategy, even grand strategy, in essence, Grant used the siege to fix the Graycoats in place at Petersburg and Richmond, and thus to deny Lee the operational and strategic initiative which the Virginian had used to such good advantage. On the peninsula, throughout 1862 and well into 1863, Grant's great entrenched camp close up against Petersburg from the east, with its incessant shelling and sharpshooting of secessionist lines, created an ongoing threat which the Southerners could not ignore. More dangerous were the attacks, some of them two-pronged, others single-strike, which Grant launched from the security of that camp against undermanned positions north of James River and against vulnerable supply lines south of the Cockade City. Nine such attacks, which I have termed offenses, punctuated the 9.5 months of the siege. Most were marked by mobile battles in the open field rather than by assaults on well-defended fortifications. The most significant of these strikes were the fourth offensive in mid-August. And Nick, what book did you read? Do you have your book with you? If you could show me that book. I think I saw it from a distance. This is Tom Howe's book on the first offensive, the initial direct attacks on the city, June 15th to 18th. Another book in that series deals with this fourth offensive in which the Yankees actually cut the Weldon Railroad at Globe Tavern. And then there is the fifth offensive, about which I have written in Richmond Redeemed, which is available here tonight in its expanded 150th anniversary edition. The operations in which the Yankees came closest to capturing Richmond with a field army that could actually have held the city. Not a handful of cavalry raiders, but a whole army, 25,000 strong. That fifth offensive. The eighth offensive, in which the Bluecoats finally extended their left flank to Hatcher's Run, and finally the ninth offensive that overwhelmed the last Confederate mobile reserves at Five Forks and then broke through a Boyce-off arm where Pamplin Park is now situated today, and thus netted both Petersburg and Richmond. Overnight, April 2nd, 3rd, 1865, Lee abandoned his communications center, abandoned his fortifications on James River, abandoned his capital itself for a last desperate flight down the Danville Railroad toward North Carolina. But North Carolina proved too far distant. The Federal Army was in too advantageous a position. The Butternut Brigades had been too badly battled throughout the Siege of Petersburg for Lee to escape. 1 week to the day after the final fighting at Petersburg came Appomattox. By that spring of 1865, indeed ever since late 1864, the Siege of Petersburg had assumed strategic dimensions. Grant made this clear in his letter of December 18th to his trusted subordinate and friend, William T. Sherman, who had just completed his devastating march to the sea. This was the first letter that Grant wrote after Sherman reached Blue Water, south of Savannah. Of course, he congratulated Sherman on the great success of the march. But then Grant went on to share his broad strategic vision of the war. And here I'll quote General Grant. My own opinion, wrote the General in Chief, is that Lee is averse to going out of Virginia. And if the cause of the South is lost, he wants Richmond to be the last place surrendered. If Lee has such views, it may be well to indulge until we have everything else in our hands. The siege thus became a strategic tool for fixing Lee and his army in the Old Dominion, while Sherman, Philip H. Sheridan, and George H. Thomas devoured the rest of the Confederacy. That is the essence of a strategic siege. So, about 9 minutes, I've told you about 9 months of the siege. No, we're not done. Just wanted to set a little context. The mobile field battles, which marked these 9 offensives, are interesting in their own right. Indeed, one of them, Poplar Spring Church, was the topic of my presentation to your round table down in the Loop, second time I addressed your group. And I know many of us like battles. But here tonight, I'd like to broaden our perspective to the operational and strategic level and suggest some enduring lessons in strategic leadership derived from the Siege of Petersburg. An operation lasting 9.5 months proclaims perseverance, both its prizes and its pitfalls. Grant's bulldog tenacity in grabbing hold of the Army of Northern Virginia in the wilderness and never letting go all the way to Appomattox is one of the greatest hallmarks of his generalship. Yet just what did this tenacity, this perseverance entail at Petersburg? Part of it, as we have seen, involved fixing the Southerners in place tactically, operationally, and strategically. Yet fixing in place did not come easily. Time and again, in the mobile field battles south of Petersburg and north of James River, Grant was defeated. Tactically. Even so, he managed to weave such setbacks into operational success. He achieved such success despite those battlefield setbacks because he remained undaunted. His calm, quiet confidence in his ability to do his job gave him the determination to keep up the struggle. Then too, his assurance in his own mind of ultimate federal victory in the siege and in the Civil War enabled him to press ahead despite temporary setbacks. Together, such self-confidence and such certainty of success gave him military peace of mind, which freed him from the doubt, fear, anxiety, and torment that had vexed so many other senior commanders, both Northern and Southern, throughout the Civil War, and which thus enabled Grant to focus on succeeding in the siege and in the war itself. Yet within such military peace of mind, Grant was neither arrogant nor bullheaded. An even greater hallmark of his strategic leadership than tenacity was his ability to learn and apply the lessons of experience. This faculty had won him victory at Vicksburg. It also produced the prize at Petersburg. When he perceived that frontal attacks, which had worked so well in the Western theater, brought only heavy losses in the East, culminating in the disastrous repulse on June 18th, covered in that book that you won, Nick. Culminating in that assault, Grant explicitly forbade such assaults against well-defended, fortified positions. He launched no further such attacks throughout the entire siege until the final onslaught on April 2, 1865. Again, when experience demonstrated that sequential two-pronged attacks on both sides of James River were not working, he progressively adjusted their timing until by late October, both strikes went forward simultaneously. And when those strikes, too, were turned back in defeat, he made an even more fundamental readjustment in his grand tactics to a massive first strikes south of the cockade city. And it was such first strikes that carried me to Hatcher's Run in February, and such first strikes that brought victory at Petersburg in April. Yet Grant was not the only senior leader to display perseverance at Petersburg. His Confederate counterpart also showed tenacity in holding that city and Richmond. Lee understood their practical and symbolic importance to the Southern war effort and to the Southern cause, and he fought to save those cities. Fought is the key concept. Lee did not sit supinely in his trenches awaiting bluecoat attack. When they left their defenses of their entrenched camp to attack him, he left his defenses to counterattack them. Although he never again controlled the strategic initiative, which remained in Grant's hands throughout the siege, the great Confederate commander repeatedly challenged the Yankees for control of the tactical and operational initiative. The ensuing battles were not static set-piece struggles of attack and defense, but fluid, mobile field battles in which the secessionists' superior knowledge of terrain often enabled them to offset their numerical weakness with surprise flank attacks. Counterattacking attackers affords tactical advantages. Even more significant, such counterattacks reflect Lee's approach to warfare. He did not equate probable disadvantage with certain loss, but rather strove to redirect the military situation to his advantage. Contrast that approach with what Joe Johnson was doing in Georgia at the same time in this operation that your field trip in 2018 will cover. Johnson would be in a position when Sherman would close in, Johnson would fall back. Sherman would close in, Johnson would fall back. Sherman would close in, Johnson would fall back. In Virginia, at the same time, Lee did not fall back, Lee fought back. When the Yankees came out to attack him, he came out to attack them. In the fifth offensive and the operations covered in Richmond Redeemed, Lee was prepared to abandon Petersburg on September 30th. So dire was the danger to his capital. Yet he did not simply yield either of those cities to that likely danger, but battled back and saved both cities. Through such fighting tenacity, Lee prolonged the security of his supply lines, his army, his capital, and his country for another 9 months. And yet the end eventually did come, and all was lost. This outcome was due, at least in part, because the Greycoats held on to Petersburg for too long. Now, I do not blame Lee for this decision or for this outcome. He did not become general-in-chief of the entire Confederate Army until February of 1865. Too late to affect the overall course of the war. The decision to remain in Richmond rested with the government. As a professional soldier of the Confederate Republic, Lee loyally carried out government policy. But there is an aspect of perseverance where Lee at Petersburg may be criticized. Unlike Grant, who learned from experience, the Virginian continued fighting in ways that had worked well earlier in the war, but that were no longer applicable by mid-1864. Unlike in Gaines Mill, Second Manassas, or Chancellorsville, his counterattacks at Petersburg almost never drove the Union strike force from the field. At best, they simply stopped that force short of its objective. Follow-up counterattacks invariably failed to overcome the Federals. Instead, they simply produced mounting casualties which the Confederates could not afford without corresponding conquests. For Lee at Petersburg, the old ways no longer worked. Such hallmarks of generalship characterized the exercise of command by Lee and Grant at Petersburg. Yet with armies ranging from approximately 50,000 to 60,000 butternuts and 100,000 to 125,000 bluecoats, those two commanders obviously could not control everything themselves, but had to rely on senior subordinates. And here too lay lessons in leadership. To begin with, both commanding generals worked with and through their senior subordinates, not around or despite them. They accorded their responsible subordinates latitude to exercise the responsibilities of their offices. As theater commander and as army group commander, the Illinoisan focused on strategy and left operations and tactics to his army and corps commanders. Army of the Potomac commander Meade earned and retained Grant's respect, although the two generals never were close the way Grant and Sherman were close. The other Yankee commander in the East, Benjamin F. Butler of the Army of the James, was the quintessential political general of the Union Army. But despite Butler's many shortcomings as a field commander, Grant both recognized the Massachusetts man's talents and also understood the necessity of working with such an influential politician. Not until Butler finally discredited himself in the powderboat fiasco in December of 1864 did Grant finally have grounds for removing the insubordinate subordinate. Butler's successor was the able professional soldier Edward Ord, who had earned Grant's respect and friendship in the Western theater. Because the Illinoisan liked Ord, he tolerated the junior officer's quaint conceits. But such antics by other senior subordinates usually cost them Grant's respect and therefore their commands. William F. Smith, William T.H. Brooks, Quincy Adams Gilmore were all relieved of command when they demanded actions or promotions that Grant was unwilling to give them. John Gibbon almost suffered the same fate, and much more tragically, by the final hours of the siege, Gouverneur Warren had so drained the reservoir of goodwill that he had earned on Little Round Top that neither Meade nor Grant would save him from the implacable wrath of Phil Sheridan. Now, Sheridan's practice of summarily relieving generals on the field of battle was atypical of the Siege of Petersburg and of the Civil War. More characteristic was Grant's practice of avoiding wholesale house cleanings of subordinates and instead working with and through them until they either succeeded or else discredited themselves with their ineptitude or their overweening ambition. Lee's command style was similar. Earlier in the war, to be sure, he had cleansed the Army of Northern Virginia of senior subordinates who had not measured up after the 7 days battle. By the time Petersburg was besieged, however, the terrible attrition of his general officers reduced him to working with and through those who remained. By then, the great Stonewall Jackson and Jeb Stuart were dead, and James Longstreet had been severely wounded in the Wilderness. The best of Lee's subordinates at Petersburg was Beauregard, but he departed on September 23rd and soon thereafter was assigned to command the Western Theater. A month later, the able Longstreet returned to duty. Among the newcomers to Corps command, Wade Hampton and John B. Gordon proved promising, but sorry to say this, Larry, Richard H. Anderson was a disappointment. Still very worthy of study, It's not a joke. Serious. Great. It's great that you're working on it, my friend. And Richard Ewell and A.P. Hale had never lived up to expectations. Indeed, just before the armies besieged Petersburg, Ewell was politely eased out of field command and put in charge of the Department of Richmond. But by then, however, the capital was no backwater. The Petersburg sector proved a prominent portion of the Petersburg siege lines. There, Ewell rendered his most crucial contribution to the Confederate cause by saving the capital from almost certain capture on September 29th in the operations about which I've written in Richmond Review. Yet whether subordinates are able or not, they are the tools with which senior leaders must work. And the chain of command, moreover, runs upward as well as downward. One of the greatest strengths of both Grant and Lee is that they understood the proper relationship between uniformed general-in-chief and constitutional commander-in-chief in a republic at war. They not only worked for, but also with President Lincoln and President Davis, and certainly not against them. Those great generals earned and retained the trust of their chief executives and thus were accorded the latitude to apply their professional military talents in behalf of the war effort. Contrast their success with what became Beauregard, Joe Johnston, George McClellan, William Rosecrans, and so many other able professional soldiers, North and South, who nullified their own professional talents by constantly quarreling with their respective governments, and who thus were kept on close rein, marginalized, shunted aside altogether. This ability to work with the president comes through clearly in the following correspondence between Grant and Lincoln in mid-July of 1864, after Petersburg had been besieged for about a month. "In my opinion," wrote the Lieutenant General, "there ought to be an immediate call for, say, 300,000 men to be put into the field in the shortest possible time." Grant then specified many benefits from increasing the fighting force, and finally he summarized, "The greater number of men we have, the shorter and less bloody will be the war." Yes, Grant did not stop there, but went on to make clear, "I give this entirely as my views and not in any spirit of dictation, always holding myself in readiness to use the material given to the best advantage I know how." The following day, the president replied, "Yours of yesterday about a call for 300,000 is received. I suppose you have not yet seen the call for 500,000, which I have just made, which I suppose covers the case." Always glad to have your suggestions. So close. And so effective were their bonds that Lincoln not only welcomed Grant's suggestions, but actually engaged in a little harmless humor about them. Not that war was a laughing matter for either of them, but that the two men were close enough to savor a smile together as they sought success. Now that exchange not only underscores their effective working relations, it also provides other lessons in strategic leadership. Grant recognized the benefit of applying overwhelming force, and he realized that the North possessed such power potentially. His great talent lay in understanding how to convert advantages into achievements. Yet all the while, he did not demand perfection. Unlike some senior leaders who insisted on waiting until everything was perfectly arranged and thus often waited forever, Grant was willing to give it a try with whatever resources were at hand. Those resources often sufficed to produce positive results. The president liked those results, and he liked the attitude of the general who was always willing to act. Lee, too, was willing to act, but under much different circumstances. He knew that the South had fewer soldiers and fewer resources, and he realized that time was not on his side. He could not wait for perfection of positions, powers, and plans, for they remained unattainable. He instead tried to make his own perfection in outcomes by seizing the strategic and operational initiative or by wresting it from the Yankees. In 1862 and 1863, he often managed to achieve such results. By the time that Petersburg was besieged, however, Grant controlled the strategic and operational initiative, and Lee was reduced to fending off federal offenses. Yet as we consider Grant and Lee and their senior subordinates, it is important that we not mistake them for the magnificent monuments that grace our national battlefields and our public places today. The statues of Meade and Hancock, Lee and Longstreet at Gettysburg, of Grant looking down the National Mall in Washington, of Wade Hampton in Columbia, South Carolina. Those giant sculptures in bronze and marble honor the generals, but they are not the generals. The generals themselves, we must always keep in mind, were real, live human beings with varying degrees of qualities, noble and ignoble, which mark the human condition. Courage and heroism and honor and perseverance and vision, to be sure, but also rivalry and jealousy and resentment and bitterness and vindictiveness. By the time armies reached Petersburg in mid-June of 1864, the soldiers were exhausted, physically and psychologically, from over 6 weeks of incessant fighting and marching and fighting and marching and fighting and marching, day after day, week after week. And so were their commanders. During the hot, dry, seemingly ceaseless siege of summer, tempers flared among Meade and his corps and division commanders, and among Confederate division commanders. Such strife certainly affected command relations and sometimes affected operations too. Such personal animosity was not confined to Petersburg, to the Civil War, or to olden times overall. It can flare up today and tomorrow. Senior strategic leaders need to recognize that reality and to be prepared to deal with it. So understanding the human dimension of high command is just one of the lessons in leadership from the siege in Petersburg. Persevering, weaving tactical setbacks into strategic success, adapting flexibility of methods to fixity of purpose, not yielding to possible threats, but fighting back against the odds, displaying strategic vision, converting advantages into achievements, and functioning effectively within chains of command, upward, downward, and laterally. All these are enduring lessons in leadership from the siege of Petersburg when Richmond was redeemed. And I thank you. Questions or comments that anyone may have? Yes, please.
At what point during the siege did attrition, and both from battlefield casualties but also from desertions, did that make it, you know, impossible to lead? And did it, was there one particular moment where the desertion rate was substantial enough to, you know, turn the tide?
An excellent question having to do with attrition, especially the attrition caused by desertion and its impact on the Siege of Petersburg, especially for the Confederates. Now there was a considerable amount of desertion going on in the first month of the Siege of Petersburg, right on up through the operations I've written about in September and in October. And some of it indeed is desertion by Confederates, but others desertion by Yankees. Though there were a lot of new recruits coming into the Union Army, individual replacements by this period of the war, and many of them were honest, committed soldiers, whatever may have induced them to enlist, whether it was patriotism, or whether it was a bounty, or whether it was an appeal to go in as a substitute. They went in and they intended to serve, and they served. But others, as we know, were bounty jumpers. And if they couldn't jump before they reached the front, and often they couldn't because they would be sent under armed guard from the rendezvous at Alexandria to the armies of Petersburg, they would desert when they reached the front. There was almost a dynamic equilibrium of Union desertions to the Confederates and Confederate desertion to the Yankees during the summer and early autumn of 1864. The Confederates would issue proclamations written in French or Gaelic or German, because a lot of these new replacements were recent immigrants, not the brave 48ers who lived in our country for over a decade before the Civil War. As we know, so many Germans came to the Chicago area. But these were people who had come right over in 1863 and 1864 and were enlisted fresh off the boat into the Army, had no commitment. And the Confederates said in these proclamations, if you come over to our side, we promise not to draft you into the Confederate Army, but we'll facilitate your finding your way back to the North if that's where you want to go. The implication being, if you want to try jumping again for an enlistment somewhere else, or at least you want to get out of harm's way, we'll make things easy. And many of the famous regiments of the Union Army that had earned, I use that verb, earned such renown in so many combats earlier in the war, had endured such heavy casualties, they were filled up with these replacements who had much less commitment, that they could not be relied upon. Case in point, 5th New Hampshire. You know what the 5th New Hampshire does on the peninsula. You know what the 5th New Hampshire does at Antietam, at Wheatfield, at Gettysburg. By the time of the Siege of Petersburg, it was garrisoning a fort, and the commanders made clear, don't let the 5th New Hampshire get near the sally port of the fort. Put another regiment there so they can't desert and get out and escape to Confederate lines. All of this changed in November of 1864. There were two tremendously important events that happened then. November 8th, the overwhelming re-election of Abraham Lincoln, the repudiation of the Copperheads in the North. McClellan was no Copperhead, but his vice presidential nominee running mate, Pendleton, was one of the most notorious of the Copperheads. And a lot of Southerners, not all, but a lot of them had placed their hopes that if Lincoln was defeated, that the incoming administration, one way or another, would recognize Confederate independence or somehow the war would come to an end. The fact that McClellan was not merely defeated but crushed in the election made unmistakably clear that there would be four more years of unrelenting war. And to underscore that problem, 1 week to the day after Lincoln was reelected, Sherman cut loose from Atlanta for his march to the sea. And even the bravest, most heroic, and most committed soldiers in the trenches of Petersburg and Richmond would lose heart when their wives, little children, or their aged parents back home in Georgia and later in the Carolinas would be placed at risk nearly of starvation, possibly even of physical danger, although Sherman never intended harm to persons, but sometimes it would happen anyway from his bombers. Such a psychological effect on the war effort helped to break the spirit of many Confederate soldiers, and there would thereafter be a great increase in Confederate desertion, some coming into the Union lines, others literally heading for the hills, and that in many ways is the origin of the term, the Appalachian country from southwestern Virginia through the western Carolinas and north Georgia and into the hill country of Alabama, abounded with gangs of deserters who organized themselves to guard against the danger that Confederate provost marshals might try to bring them back into the ranks. And so it's really starting in November and through December and on into 1865 that this attrition begins to take its effect as caused by desertion. Lee had long lacked the ability, the numbers, and the combat capability, the fighting edge to attack effectively. And by the later portions of the siege, he lost even the ability to defend effectively, so attenuated were his lines with so few men remaining.
What was the second event in November?
The March to the Sea.
Oh, okay.
Sherman cutting loose on November 15th and then culminating in the capture of Savannah on December 21st. Now, you use the word attrition, you very understandably went on to detail it in terms of desertion, and I responded to you accordingly. I'd like to share with you a few thoughts on a term that is often applied to the Grant's conduct of operations in Virginia in 1864 and 65 to say that he waged a war of attrition, and indeed he did. But let me tell you what I mean by that and what I do not mean by that. I do not mean June 3rd at Cold Harbor. Let's think about Grant here in the Midwest, this son of the Midwest, his two brigades at Belmont, his army of the Tennessee, in which so many Illinois and Wisconsin and Iowa and other Midwestern regiments served. What did he do with that army? He attacked at Belmont, he attacked at Henry and Donelson, he attacked at Shiloh, not Shiloh Sunday, but Shiloh Monday. He attacked at Hatchie Bridge in the follow-up to Second Corinth. He attacked at Vicksburg. He attacked at Lookout Mountain and Missionary Ridge. It was through the tactical attack upon the field of battle that Grant gained tactical success, operational success, strategic success, that earned him promotion to Major General of Volunteers, Brigadier General of Regulars, Major General of Regulars, Lieutenant General of Regulars, the first American officer since George Washington. to hold the grade of Lieutenant General, first United States officer. Of course, Dick Anderson had earned that promotion, and 21 other Confederate generals. Grant was the first United States officer since George Washington to earn that rank. It was that he earned his promotion, but more than just promotion in rank, he had earned increasing responsibility and increasing opportunity to wage war in behalf of the Union war effort, and he had achieved so much in the West with breaking the Confederate defense line through Kentucky, with opening the Mississippi River, with relieving the siege of Chattanooga. It should not surprise us then that this approach to warfare, which had served him and the Union so well in the Western theater, would be the approach that he would apply when he came east. But in 6 weeks of bloody fighting, from May 5th in the wilderness to June 18th at Petersburg, Grant learned that the frontal attack, which had worked against the likes of John B. Floyd and John C. Pemberton and Braxton Bragg, was not working against Robert E. Lee and the Army of Northern Virginia. So he learned and applied the lessons of experience, and therefore he passed over to his war of attrition, which is not a war, a tactical war, to say, well, if I can kill 10 Confederates, I'm willing to lose 100 or 1,000 of my own men because I can replace them and Lee can't replace them. That's not Grant's war of attrition. It is a much broader operational and strategic war of attrition in which he wears down the Confederate will and the Confederate capability to keep up the war, and as I've described already in another context, ultimately where he pins Lee in place at Petersburg while Sherman and Sheridan and Thomas attrit or devour the rest of the Confederacy. Grant's war of attrition is waged in the strategic and grand strategic realms. And so, as you think about your operations in 1864, please do not equate June 3rd and Cold Harbor with Grant. It no more characterizes him than Malvern Hill typifies Robert E. Lee. Both of those great soldiers were far superior commanders to what happened in those two unfortunate days of the war. Other question, Bob. Did you have, Mr. Zucker, did you have a question?
Yes, I did. What month during all of this did the Battle of the Crater take place?
July.
You say what time?
When? What month during all
this? July 30th, in the third offensive at the Siege of Petersburg. This was the first major offensive that Grant actually launched after the failure of the direct assault covered in the book that you won, Nick, the direct assaults of June 15th to 18th, and the initial failure to cut the Weldon Railroad on June 22nd and 23rd. Thereafter, the armies were quiescent until the end of July, partly because they were so tired they needed some rest, which a siege context could afford it. But also because for the only period in the whole course of what I like to call the Virginia campaign, the 11-month long campaign between Grant and Lee from May of 64 to April of 65, Lee actually managed to wrest the strategic initiative from Grant by sending Jubal Early down the valley, across the Potomac, through Maryland, to the outskirts of Washington. And Grant actually had to call off one of his planned offensives and to dispatch first one division, but ultimately five divisions of its own force, and to divert two divisions of reinforcements and another two brigades of reinforcements out to the valley to deal with Sheridan. So it wouldn't be until late July that Grant was in a position to launch his third offensive, which began with the first battle of Deep Bottom north of James River on July 24th to 27th, and then Hancock was withdrawn from Deep Bottom, and the mine was detonated on July 30th on the Petersburg front, which was a total fiasco. Did I see your hand?
Oh, yeah, it's kind of a far-ranging question. I'm just wondering if you could speak more on the trenches in Petersburg compared to the First World War. You know, I knew there were some foreign observers at the time, but it doesn't seem like anyone really took anything from it.
Okay, a very good question. Petersburg itself and Richmond itself had permanent fortifications that were created relatively at leisure, not so much with Richmond. After the Battle of Seven Pines and before the start of the 7 Days Battle, we know that Lee ordered his troops to begin fortifying a position on the across the Williamsburg Road on the peninsula, and that became part of the exterior line, three rings of fortifications around the Confederate capital, which were elaborated upon after the danger had receded when Lee drove McClellan away and raised the first siege in Richmond in the early summer of 1862. Petersburg was fortified at leisure with a ring of fortifications around the eastern, southern, and western sides of the city. Now, despite the ability to prepare these fortifications with no danger imminent, or perhaps because there was relatively little urgency because no danger was imminent, these fortifications left a great deal to be desired. They had blind spots and inability to provide flanking fire, which when the tests finally came in starting in June of 1864, certainly continued to be the case at Fort Harrison, battle that I've written about, discovered that these permanent fortifications were not merely as strong as one might assume. Nevertheless, they provided a nucleus for the Confederate defense. That nucleus was greatly expanded by the use of field fortifications, which Lee had began using to some extent at Fredericksburg and over the winter of 62-63, but which would be carried to their ultimate expression in the Civil War the lines that would be extended east from Richmond to New Market Heights and south from Petersburg to cover the supply lines running into the Cockade City. A much different situation from Port Hudson, in which you've done such outstanding work, Larry, but reflecting the realities with which General Lee was faced at that time. But many of the battles that make up the Siege of Petersburg do not involve attacking fortifications. They are mobile, fluid field battles as Grant is trying to get around the Confederate left flank north of James River or the Confederate right flank south of the Appomattox River. And it's only after a given offensive ends that the two sides will extend their fortifications either to incorporate new federal conquests or to protect against dangers which an unsuccessful Union advance has now alerted the Confederates. The extent to which these fortifications influenced European commanders in World War I, I don't see a lot of indication of it because the planners on both the German and the French side still thought they could wage a mobile warfare and for the French to rely on élan or spirit to succeed, and the Germans have worked out their master war plan, the Schlieffen plan, but then they didn't commit as many forces as Schlieffen had projected when he developed his plan. So when it was actually applied, it didn't work. It was defeated in the First Battle of the Marne. The situation eventually stagnated, and just as a matter of self-defense, they eventually ran their lines of fortifications all the way from Switzerland to the North Sea. But a much different sort of situation than had been in the case in the Civil War. Mike?
I appreciate a few comments on the use of the colored troops, particularly by Benjamin Butler, and also perhaps the use of prisoners by the Southerners.
Okay. Thank you for those two excellent questions. The Emancipation Proclamation authorized the raising of black troops for the Union Army. By the start of 1864, there would be one black division under General Edward Ferrero, which would include Illinois' own 29th U.S. Colored Infantry. That was attached to the 9th Corps, and that corps initially operated independently of the Army of the Potomac within Grant's Army Group, but then in late May of 1864 was put within within the Army of the Potomac, as Burnside magnanimously waived his higher rank and willingly subordinated himself to me within the Army of the Potomac. So from late May to late November 1864, there was a division of black troops in the Army of the Potomac. It was largely used to guard the Army's wagon trains during the overland campaign from the Wilderness to Petersburg, involved in a little skirmishing on May 7th, but not much fighting. Its first big battle was at the crater on July 30th. It had been slated to spearhead the breakthrough after the mine was detonated, but Meade was concerned that if the troops did not perform well, the operation might go for naught, or might be accused of sacrificing the black troops as cannon fodder, in effect. So he required Burnside to select one of his white divisions, which is a command decision that can be made. That for something that is utterly indefensible, however, instead of rationally judging that General Potter is the best division commander, General Wilcox is the most experienced division commander, he just said, draw lots. And General Ledlie drew the lots. Said, you lose, you get to lead the attack. That's not the way to select a spearhead commander at any period. It certainly led to proof the black division was eventually committed. It was totally repulsed along with the other troops, and the Battle of the Crater was a fiasco. That division was slightly engaged at the First Battle of Hatcher's Run on October 27th, not very much so. The whole 9th Corps didn't see much action in that battle. Now, the situation is very different in Ben Butler's Army of the James. He starts out the campaign with a brigade of U.S. colored cavalry and a division of U.S. colored infantry, 7 regiments of U.S. colored infantry. And those troops will be engaged from the first day of the fight at Petersburg on June 15th, and they will also be engaged at the second battle of Deep Bottom. They're heavily engaged. The battle about which I wrote, the biggest, bloodiest battle by black troops in the entire Civil War. In no other battle of the Civil War was there such a large force structure. There were 2 regiments of Louisiana Native Guards at Port Hudson, which served with great renown. There are 14 regiments that are heavily engaged in this battle. the black soldiers earned 14 medals of honor for their service, as well as one white officer of those regiments. They would continue to be engaged in the second battle of the Darbytown Road and the second battle of Fair Oaks. But Butler, and by then, Butler's army had been built up to two divisions. He had two divisions of black troops by August of 1864. And now there are two currents at work here. When the Ninth Corps leaves the Army of the Potomac after Fredericksburg and is sent down to Newport News, then its first and second divisions are sent up to Kentucky at Burnside's request, because he's been put in command at the Department of the Ohio. But the third division is left behind and will eventually be absorbed into the Siege of Suffolk and the Peninsula Campaign of 1863. Maybe you'll take a field trip on that one. Well, now, fast forward a year. The Ninth Corps is back in the Eastern Theater, back in the Siege of Petersburg. Burnside said, I'd like to have my old 3rd Division back. Problem is, it has not remained intact. One regiment has been captured in Plymouth, another regiment is down in North Carolina. Some of the other troops are scattered throughout the Army of the James. So Butler says, I tell you what, I'll give you 6 big regiments of Pennsylvania troops that have just come down. My army, in exchange for Ferrero's Black Division, which had fought at the crater in the Ninth Corps. And by now, Burnside was gone. Park was in command of the Ninth Corps. Park did not much care for U.S. colored troops. Meade did not much care for U.S. colored troops. They were happy to be rid of the Black Division. Butler was happy to have more Black troops. Butler was one of the great defenders of using U.S. colored troops in the Civil War. And so this exchange was made in late November of 1864, and on December 3rd, Butler reshuffled the whole deck and put all of the white infantry in the Army of the James into the 24th Corps, and put the 2 black divisions of the Army of the James, plus this division from the 9th Corps, into the new 25th Corps. So you now have a whole corps of black troops in the Army of the James, except for its artillery brigade, which was white. There was only one black battery of light artillery, and it had actually, in the Army of the James, and it had actually been sent back to Norfolk in this period of the war. But all the infantry are black. But we need to keep in mind, the 25th Corps never fights together as a corps. It's often heralded as being created as an all-black corps, and indeed it was, but it never fought together as a corps. Largely because Butler himself would be relieved of command within a less than 5 weeks after it was created. If he had stayed in charge of the Army of the James, he would almost surely have used this corps. But he wasn't. His successor, Ord, didn't like colored troops, didn't like the Butler men who were associated with colored troops. And so he did not want to use 25th Corps as an organized force. One division was sent as part of Terry's provisional corps involved in the capture of Fort Fisher on January 15, 1865, and would later be incorporated into the reconstituted 10th Corps. But when the 9th Offensive was launched in late March, the final offensive that would bring victory at Petersburg, one of the great strategic surprises, or at least operational surprises, of the siege. The ultimate outcome of my battles, not the immediate outcome, but the ultimate outcome, was that the Yankees established such a large presence north of James River that Lee had to leave a countervailing force that he could not spare from the defenses of Houston. When the time came in late March of 65, Grant withdrew four divisions from the peninsula under Ord, including one black division, two white divisions, and the cavalry division, and brought them down to join in the grand onslaught south of Petersburg. And the Butternuts did not realize that the Yankees had left until it was too late, and did not start sending troops from the peninsula down to Petersburg until the very final days. They arrived only in time to plug the last gap and save Petersburg for a few more hours on the afternoon and night to be second before the city was abandoned. So thereafter, you have this one division of black troops operating as part of Ord's Army of the James. Now, south of James River, Godfrey Weitzel, the 25th Corps commander, has been left on the peninsula with the remaining division of U.S. colored troops plus one white division. So he has a de facto corps command, but it's not an all black corps. It's one black division, one white division. Those are the troops that march into Richmond unopposed on the morning of April 3rd, 1865, because the secessionists have abandoned the city for their retreat. During the Appomattox campaign, Ord uses the occasion to relieve William Birney, commanding the Black Division, his army from command, and to break up the Black Division and attach its two brigades to white divisions in his command. It would only be on April 10th, the day after Appomattox, that the black troops would be brought back together in a division under General Richard Jackson. And then by late May, as part of the great concentration against the Trans-Mississippi Department, they would bring the 4th Corps down from Tennessee, and the 13th Corps from Alabama, and the 1st and 2nd Divisions of the 25th Corps, including Weitzel, the Corps headquarters, are sent from Virginia to constitute Sheridan's new army to overrun Texas if the Confederates attempt to keep fighting. Well, the Confederacy, of course, collapses. There is no real resistance, but they occupy the state. And a lot of the other black troops, including Hawkins' division that had participated in the siege of Mobile, will be attached to Weitzel's corps in Texas. Well, now, there is the great outcry at the end of the war. Bring the boys home. We've won the war. Some planters, you know, wanted to use this great Union army to defeat the Indians. Of all the Indian wars that had been raging during the Civil War, to overawe the French in Mexico, to occupy the South. But there was such an outcry that it just couldn't be kept in the ranks, except for the U.S. colored troops. There was no one to speak up for them in Congress. The contraband regiments had been raised in the South. Now, Illinois, 29th, the other regiments from the North, the 11 black regiments raised in Pennsylvania, they all had constituents. They all came home. But a lot of these black troops continued serving throughout 1865, well into December of 1866. The last regiment of volunteers in the United States service for the Civil War was the Kentucky Black Regiment that was not mustered out until the end of December of 1865. Continued to perform reconstruction duty in the South. Very important service, but not combat service as a corps. Butler was a great proponent of the black troops, but many other Union commanders did not have high regard for them.
You've had some great questions, so I don't want to break that up, but I do want to thank you so much for an excellent presentation.
Thank you
so much.